Hey, our ambitious developer, today we have a bunch of great news for you guys, and as previously, we're gonna make some changes. But first, let's just play the intro. So welcome in fifth episode of Frontend News Podcast. It's me, Krzysztof. I'm here with my teammate Tomasz. Wait, where is Tomasz? There is no Tomasz because today we're shooting remotely. Sometimes as a developer you need to travel to meet your clients, and this is the case. So meet a Tomasz. Tomasz, how do you feel at office alone?
Hello everyone. Well, it's different. I feel alone. I feel abandoned. And I'm really sad that we cannot do this together in the single studio. But I'm really happy that we set up all of the equipment and we can do this even remotely. So cannot wait for this fantastic news we have prepared for this chapter. And Chris, how are the things on your side? How is the weather? How is, you know, everything?
Everything is perfect on my side. Working remotely, I cannot wait to see you in the office, drink a coffee and start the next sixth episode of Frontend News. But for today, let's kick off the agenda. Tomasz, what's first?
Guys, for today we have a bunch of great news starting from the beginning. We would like to speak about the Flutter 2, which has arrived recently.
The next one. Come on, guys, it's jQuery 3.6 release.
After jQuery, we will be speaking about Electron version 12.
We'll show you what's new in VS Code, new update.
And we will be talking about that Google is speeding up its release cycle.
There will be small amount of knowledge about demo and its experimental support for web GPU.
And at the end, we will say hi to the Gatsby version 3.
We are all set, so let's get started. Tomasz, go on.
As we said, at the beginning, we will be talking about the Flutter 2, which is the brand new version, brand new release for this tooling. And I'm really proud to announce that Flutter 2 is dedicated not only to build the mobile applications, but the breaking change in the Flutter 2 is that we can develop an application to any kind of platform we can imagine.
Every kind of platform?
Yep, so we will have like iOS, Android, Windows, macOS and Linux operational systems that
sounds amazing.
Will be supported. Flutter 2 will be supported by Chrome, Safari, Firefox, Edge. We can even, you know, run the Flutter apps on TVs, smartwatch, some smart house systems, and believe me, we can also use Flutter to develop an app for your car. How does it sound?
For my car?
Yes.
Sounds amazing. I have Toyota and it has no Android Android car yet.
Yeah.
So I can't develop for my car, but guys, maybe you are lucky and you can develop for your cars. Let's see. But this news, wow, it's amazing. I mean, having one code to rule them all.
Yeah, sounds like this magic ring from the Lord of the Rings, yes? One to rule them all. And I'm really happy that you mentioned about that you have the Toyota, because I don't know if you already know this, but Toyota has a plan to use the Flutter 2 for their next gen cars to write all the application, all the setup with the Flutter, man. So, well, maybe in the future you will be riding a car with your own applications on it.
What a coincidence that I mentioned Toyota, isn't it?
Great. Guys, so yeah, believe me, it's worth to check, and the link is in the description for the documentation. Check it out on your own, and it's worth to play with the Flutter, because it will be, and it is, really nice and advanced tooling to build your apps.
Tomasz, is it still built on the Dart?
Yes. Under the hood, it's still the Dart. And so you need to learn a new language, which is not so hard.
Sad face.
You want everything to be in JavaScript. I know this.
Exactly. because we are burning with this Flutter too. So let's go to jQuery 3.6.
Exactly. Yeah, we have a new release for the jQuery, which is 3.6.0. So in the newest release, we can find a bunch of important bug fixes, along with some improvements for the currently existing code base. So yeah, we can find fixes like for retrieving dimensions on table rows in Firefox, which was crashing, or the crash in Chrome when a focus out event is triggered on a removed element. This has been fixed too. So if you want to know what's more, just, you know, check the release notes. And yeah, we are still waiting for the jQuery version 4. It's still in progress, but in the nearest future, we should expect the brand new jQuery 4.
When was the last time you used jQuery? I think my last project, it was even before Backbone.js release. I don't really remember, but it was such a long time ago.
I remember I was using jQuery at a very beginning at my career. I was working with you, Chris. I don't know if you remember. I know you remember.
Of course I remember.
Yeah, we were working together, and the first projects we did, like simple pages, me as a newbie, I was responsible for some simple apps, simple pages. I was using jQuery to achieve what I want, but from my observation, jQuery is not only for handling like the simple UI interactions, because we can use jQuery for much complex use cases. It depends on the architecture and on some assumptions. So I know that everyone is laughing on jQuery, but it's still being one of the most widely used JavaScript tools. So
it's still a very big part of the market, according to the last post we saw. So, whoa, great news. The next one was Electron 20.0.
No, man, close enough, but it was 12. We need to wait for 20.
Whoa, 12. Okay, so guys, the next one was about Electron 12.0.
Exactly. So let me present the brand new release of Electron 12. We have some breaking changes inside the newest version, along with some minor fixes or improvements. So the most important fact that we should notice is that the Chromium, which is under the Electron, has been updated to the 89 version, along with the Node.js, which has been updated to version 14.16. So the Electron team is trying to keep up to date all the tooling that is under the Electron and is responsible to run our code.
Sounds good. I haven't used it in commercial project yet, but looking forward. That's all from Electron, Tomasz. Can we go to the VS Code?
Yep. Now it's time for Visual Studio Code. And for those who are using it daily and have the brand new MacBooks with the M1 processor, this should be a really good information, because from now you will be able to use Visual Studio Code without any emulator tool like Rosetta. So we should get the better performance working with the Visual Studio Code, and everything should be, you know, processed much faster, more efficient, and make our daily work much easier for us. I really like it. But unfortunately, I do not have the M1 processor yet, so it doesn't affect me. But I believe there is a lot of developers who are using Visual Studio Code with new MacBooks, and for now, their work will be easier. So yeah, that's great. If you want to know more what are the changes inside, you know, fixes, as always, the link is in the description under this podcast. So exactly, Chris, exactly. You're pointing to the correct place. Let's do this together. 1, 2, 3. Great, man. Cool. Yeah. Let's be serious for a while. The link is in the description. Check it on your own. And let's move forward to another topic, which is...
Okay, guys, it's worth to check. And the next one is about Google. Tomasz. What's with Google?
Okay, the news will be short, but pretty important. So the Google decide to decrease the time between the next releases of the Chrome browser. So they shortened the period of release from 6 weeks to the 4 weeks. Well, what does it mean exactly? It means that we will obtain all the bug fixes, improvements, updates more often, because every 4 weeks, and this should react on the, you know, dynamically changing web ecosystem, because all of the tooling evolves pretty fast. So the Google team decided to be one step ahead and do the releases more often, and that's it.
We love those guys.
We love those guys. They did a really awesome job, man.
Okay, guys, so we have two last news. The next one is about Deno. Tomasz, go ahead.
Okay, guys, so the Deno team decided to release the new version, which is 1.8, and allow us to use their experimental API to play with the web GPU. It means that we can run our code, we can directly programming on the graphical processor unit, and that opens a lot of new possibilities for us. Imagine that you have a complex machine learning system and everything is being written in JavaScript. As we know, the JavaScript in most of the cases, this is the single thread language, and it's not really efficient if we are talking about processing tons of data or processing some complex algorithms. And now we can move all of this logic straight to the GPU of our laptop or computer or our PC, okay? And trigger this code in there parallel to what we are doing with the UI. So, man, it opens a tons of new possibilities.
Sounds amazing. There is no more questions, Tomasz. Nice explanation. Okay, so the next one is about Gatsby 3.0.
Okay, exactly. Thank you, Chris, for mentioning that. Let's say hi to Gatsby 3.0. I really like this tool. I remember I did a lot of projects with Gatsby. Nowadays I'm using Next.js, but Gatsby is still a big player on the market, and it's worth to be up to date with this tool. The creators of the Gatsby promised that in the new release, the Gatsby has been speed up by 80% for the local development mode. So creating your apps will be faster and easier from the developer perspective. The faster builds of our, you know, production code makes the deployments also be faster, and our code will hit the server more frequently and without any delays we had in the previous versions. The Gatsby team also fixed some things around performance and improve a lot in terms of how the JavaScript is being handled during the static site generation, for example. And this makes that our apps will receive the higher notes in the Lighthouse. So a lot of improvements. And Chris, if you want to know more, I highly recommend to you.
I want. Yeah, I like the ratings in the Lighthouse, and we already mentioned this. So how high they can go?
Yeah, so they increase the rating by, well, it depends, but the core vitals has been increased much, like by almost 10% by default. So even if we had like 98%, now we should receive 99 or even 100 by default. But as we know, everything depends on the developers and how they will develop the app, because not everything is on the framework side.
It depends. I love this when we do the estimation. It depends, guys.
Exactly. Yeah. It's good that you mention it. Okay, so that's all from the news side from us. I hope you enjoy the show and you get the knowledge you were waiting for. Chris, you want to add something?
Guys, of course I do. So I want to invite you for Curated Project and Tips and Trips. Curated Project with me and Tips and Trips with Tomasz. See you in the next section.
Bye-bye, guys.
Hey everybody, I'm sure you already heard about Marseille City, one of the largest in France and the biggest of Provence region. So a couple days before, we had a chance to start exploring this city online. I'm sure you already know why. Probably this is the only way to visit this city today, unless you live here. So after a short loading time, with a quite cool loader by the way, we see this question, why not to discover this city differently this year? Let's click this button and wait for magic happens, which for starters shows us the peninsula, finally moving to Marsili City. I really appreciate this kind of drone-like animation. So now we see only part of this city. The whole map is divided into districts. We can zoom in, zoom out, move the map, whatever. It's like real-time rendering 3D model of whole city infrastructure. There are many checkpoints you can go through and explore with 360 panorama viewports. The idea was to make it authentic, so you are not only going to see like breathtaking landscapes, but you also see restaurants, bigger and smaller interiors, shops, factories. Guys, you just enter this experience and explore yourself, you will enjoy it. Every panorama viewport has its own description and even geographical coordinates, for those who are obviously curious. But the main advantage of this project is that it connects many industries together. We read about the factories and quickly link to their websites. We discover many facts we didn't know about. For example, Popular and its alcohol production line. You can also easily navigate through all the checkpoints in the menu. Okay guys, how do you like this website? I really enjoyed it.
Hello guys, this is another round of Tips and Tricks with me, with Tommy K. Today I would like to speak about the problem that is quite common, but maybe not so observable, especially if you're like at the beginning at your front-end journey or somewhere in the middle, you're not always thinking about it. So imagine you're building the page. It don't have to be a complex application. Let's say it's a landing page where you display a lot of images, and those images obviously has different size. They can load faster, they can load slower, but you want to give the user like the best experience. So what can you observe when you will initially load the page is that some of the images may not be displayed right from the beginning. You will see the blank placeholder without any kind of information that you're actually doing something in that place. So it does not look good and it does not offer the good user experience at all. There is a small improvement we can do around how we deal with the images. And for the example, I will use the React. And to present the example, I will use the React, and we are going to create the image component that will display the loader and hide the loader right after our image has been finally loaded. Does it make sense? Yeah, it's pretty simple, but I want to share this with you to present how fast you can achieve the better user experience, and you can make your image component better without any libraries or any extra dependencies. Okay, so let me create the image component. And yeah, if you're looking for a really good IDE online, I highly recommend Code Sandbox. You can play not only by yourself, but you can play at the same project with all your team. So it's like having your IDE and configuration over project in the cloud, and it's really amazing. Okay, so let's create our image component. And yeah, obviously what it will obtain from the prop site, it will be source, okay? Because we want to display an image coming from external source. And it's good time to mention that to fetch images, we will be using Lorem Flickr service that offer us obtaining the random images. And we can define some params like, you know, width, height, or even what kinds of what type of images we want to see, okay? And there is much more configuration, obviously, but we will be using at the basic usage. Okay, so we've got still nothing, still nothing. Yeah, I will add some styles later, a little bit later. Let's create the structure at first. So this will be our container for the image. Let's give it a name, class name. It will be an image container. And obviously we want to display an image that has the source from source and yeah, alternate text. If I will not define it, it will underline this, and I don't want to have any underline, so let's call it just test image, okay? And see what happened next. Yeah, if I will use image word in alternate text, it gives me an error. This is yeah, this is interesting. Okay, so let's import our image. Okay, and we did not define the source, and for the source we are going to use the Flickr, and let's say Paris. We will display the images for Paris. Yeah, it loads pretty fast, but let's use the bigger size. It will indicate the longer loading. Okay, see, there is some period of time that that we need to wait until the whole image will be displayed, okay? And this is normally ignored on almost all of the pages, but our page will be unique, and we will use loaders to indicate that our component still doing something, okay? So let's move forward. We want to display the spinner inside the image component and hide the spinner right after our image has been loaded. So how to achieve that? Okay. We will hook into the onload function, which is the native, let's say native event for the image tag. And this is onload. And what we want to do onload is to set some value that will indicate that image has been actually loaded. And to achieve that, let's use React hooks, use state false. So we say that from the beginning our image is not loaded, which is obviously is true. Set is loaded. Okay, great. And after our image is loaded, we set is loaded true. Okay, great. Still we do not have any kind of indicator or loader, so let's display it here. So we need to check if it's loaded. If it's not loaded, we want to display our loader class name, because it's React, and let's call it loader. Does it make sense? I believe so. Great. Let's work on the loader a little bit. It won't be a complex issue, because we will use the CSS to define our loader, and to keep it simple. We have some empty app class, don't worry about it for now. Okay, so we've got our loader, and let's say we want to display it inline block. Later maybe we'll display some text or not, we will see, okay? And we want to have it like 80 pixel to 80 pixel. Great. And that's our container for the loader. And what we are going to animate is the border. So we will use the after element, pseudo element, to achieve this animation. Let me put some attributes to achieve what we want. We need to define the size, and we want to display it circular, so border radius, we will set it to 50%. And yeah, we are going to animate the border, so we need to define it, and it will be 6 pixels solid, and for the color we will use just pure black. And we need to override the color, because for now it will be the full circle, and we want to have some gaps in it. So border color, the first quarter will be black, the second one will be transparent, the third will be black, the third will be black, and the fourth one is going to be transparent. And we want to use animation, custom animation we are going to create, and it will last 1 and 2 seconds, and it will be linear and infinite. Great. So one step to be there is to define the loader animation. The animation will be simple, we just want to rotate our border, and for the very beginning, yeah, transform rule, rotate. And if we achieve 100, so it will be the very end of our animation. This is our target. We want to transform and rotate with 360 degrees. Okay, that should work for us. Hopefully, we will see. I need to check if we import styles. Yes, we are doing it. Great. So for now, let's hide the image and check if the loader is there. Great. Yeah, we see the loader. It's okay for us for now. So let's check how it looks like. It's not what we want to achieve. Let's clean it up a little bit. So our image container need a little bit of styling. Let's assume the case that we have the predefined size of the image, just to make the example simpler. But obviously the width and height of the image can be fluid, depending, for example, on the parent container. And you can build a grid, you can use the flexbox. We are going to use pixels to define the width and height. So our images will be like, let's say, 200 pixels tall and 300 pixels wide. Okay. We don't want to show the overflow of the image container, and we want to adjust our image to fulfill the container with the width, and height will be adjust automatically. Great, our image is resized, but it's still not the perfect solution. As you can see, we have some jumpy behavior, like the loader is for 1 millisecond maybe, it's above the image. As you can see, the image is being displayed under the loader, and we don't want to have such behavior. And for this example, we are going to use the absolute position for image. And our container should contain the position relative, obviously. And we will put some position absolute in here and define the left and top as the 0, 0 to start from the left corner. Great. And our image container is going to have everything centered. I mean, we want to center our loader, so I'm going to use justify items is going to be set to. Okay, how it behaves? Not perfect. Okay. Why not? Why it's not working? Come on, guys. Does anyone know why? Maybe if I will use the text align center, it will make the job for now. Still not. Oh, come on. Okay, we will resolve it a little bit later. The important fact is that we want to add some, you know, background just to make it a little bit more attractive. As you can see, we display the loader, and right after the image is being fetched from the server, we replace it with this image. Cool. What we want to do next is to support the errors, because not all the time our image can be fetched with success. We have the on error event we can hook in and set error to, oh, what's going on? Set error to true. We do not have this function yet, so let's use it from the hook. Set error is error, let's say. Great. If there is an error, we want to display the div with maybe some text, let's say not found. And if there is an error, we don't want to display the image at all. Okay, we have some small error in here. We need to use the opposite value for this error to display the image, because if there is no error, we want to display the image. Yep, it's obvious. So sorry for that. Okay, we can move forward. Let's check if it works. So let's mess the URL, not found. Okay. We had some small bug because we need to display the loader, and we want to display the loader when the file is loading or if there is an error. Okay. And we want to, where is our styles here? Okay, and we want to display it in the columns. Great. Justify content, that's correct. This is why it's not being centered. Sorry, and we don't need this, obviously. Cool, so this is how our placeholder will look like when the image is not in there. So let's play with it a little bit. Okay. We have one image, for now. Okay, as you can see, it works. Let's check how it will behave with a few items. Maybe not few, like a lot more images, and let's customize it. So let's put some cities in here. Oh man, so many cities. Cleveland, Boston. Okay, it's enough. I don't want to display all of the cities all around the world. So let's check it out. Great, as you can see, the different images has a different timing when they are fully fetched. And thanks to our loader, it looks a little bit more attractive for the user, instead of displaying the blank placeholder without any image. So I highly recommend to think about the user experience and to take care about the details. And yeah, that's it. It works, and we achieve our assumptions from the beginning. I want to see if the error will be handled properly. Okay, so some of the images are not being fetched. That's because we have modified the URL, and obviously there is no image under that URL. Okay, guys. Thank you. Thanks for your attention. Please don't forget to subscribe our channel and leave likes and comments. See you soon.
Okay, guys, that's it from today's episode. I hope you like it. And if you do, just follow us on YouTube.
Check our Instagram.
Come on. Again, Instagram. Okay, check it out on Instagram and Twitter.
Spotify.
All the playlists. Come on. See you next episode.
Ha 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 ha.